me for the big issue here on the Russia of course on Avant TV. You can join the conversation on all our social media platforms, X, Facebook, and you can watch us live on the New Vision Victor app. Of course, tomorrow being a Friday and 6th of October, the faction of FDC in Naja Nankumbi is planning a delegates conference where they plan to elect their new leaders. However, their counterparts in Katonga have rolled out their new roadmap, and they expect their delegates conference to be in March next year. Joining me right now is Honorable Okin Pipi Ojora, and that is the MP of Ochoa West in Kitugum District, and he's going to help us discuss this delegates conference. Good morning, sir, and thank you for joining me.
Good morning, moderator.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Yes, I'm very happy to be host here in the TV.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Well, tomorrow we are going to have a delegates conference in Naja Nankumbi. First of all, are you going to take part?
You know, I'm a member of parliament. Mm-hmm. And being a member of parliament, it means you need to be very organized. And also you need to go by the rule of the game, which means you make laws, you make policies, you make guidelines, which guides operations for institutions.
Yes.
And this is the within the FDC context, we have guiding principles of FDC. Mm. We have the constitution of FDC. We have some policies of FDC, and all recent also we have had the strategic plan for FDC. These are policy documents, legal documents that guide the operations of the party. And if they are not being followed, if we are just trying to twist the law and we do our own things, I won't be party to that. And that's why I don't think even the forthcoming delegate conference of tomorrow is not called according to the guiding principles of FDC, which is the party constitution.
Why do you say it's not called according to the guidelines of FDC? Because the Secretary General has signed off of it, there is funding.
First of all, when you look at the constitution, I wish I'd carried one here. When you look at the constitution of FDC, is only the party chairperson who calls for delegate conference. Mm-hmm. He is the only person mandated to call for a delegate conference. He is the only person who is, because he's the one going to chair the delegate conference anyway.
Mm.
And the National Council, for example, he is the party president who is supposed to chair the National Council. Mm-hmm. So in a situation where you call for a meeting of a delegate conference, without the approval and consent of the party chairman, does that one makes it legally binding? But absolutely, it doesn't make it legally binding.
But in an event that Birigwa has, the party chairperson, Waiswa Birigwa, has absconded from his work as the chairperson, at least what the Naja Nankumbi claim, wouldn't the Secretary General then have the power to call the delegates conference?
No, there is no legal instrument in the party which indicates that if the chairperson is not available, then the Secretary General is supposed to call for a delegate conference. I don't think there is any legal instrument in party FDC which stipulates that one.
No.
It is very clear we have had vice chairpersons. Vice chairpersons can step in the absence of the chairperson. And in this case, in FDC, we have four vice chairpersons. Now, if the chairperson has allegedly absconded from his responsibility, then why don't we give the mandate to the vice chairpersons to call for a delegate conference? Because they would step in.
Mm.
But unfortunately, I don't think even the chairpersons are the ones, the deputy chairpersons are the ones calling for this delegate conference. Instead, I've seen the electoral commissioner who has called for this delegate conference. Mm. So actually, basically, in my view, I think even the relevance of the party, the delegate conference is not there. It can be challenged in the court of law.
Mm.
And therefore, it will be null and void. So why this ping-pong of legal lacuna all the time? You know, you find somebody's doing this, somebody's doing this. And when you look at the elections that has been, the so-called elections that have been done, It is actually not elections. I would even say it is selection. I have seen my name selected. I'm not elected.
You've been selected.
I've been selected to attend the delegate conference from the people of Kidgo. And I was asking, when did we ever conduct an election? We never conducted an election. I will look at the list of the delegates who are supposed to attend tomorrow's delegate conference. My name is there. I never contested for any position, but how come my name is there? So as a person who wants to promote democracy in this country, I don't think what we are going on in FDC, on both sides, is going to help us, you know, go through a normal legal process of building the institution of a party like FDC. There's a lot to be desired.
When you look at what is happening, like you're saying, what is going to happen tomorrow is not according to the party structures. Why do you think it's happening? What is happening in Najana, Nkumbi and Katonga that is bringing on this split in the party?
I want to think that there must be a very serious external factor.
And what external factor
I'm seeing is probably coming from the side of the ruling government. Because I've been observing political trends in this country, and I've seen that the NRM government is very scared of any kind of opposition that comes up. And if you are the head of a government, you are the head of state, and you make a pronouncement and an announcement that, you know, by the end of 2021, we shall not have any opposition, which means you have never appreciated the role of opposition in any kind of system. Oppositions are there to look at alternatives, to wake you up, to say this is wrong, this is not correct, this is supposed to be done. And if you don't have any opposition in any governing system, it means you yourself don't know what you want. So when you hear this kind of statement coming from the head of state, that, you know, by 2021,
2026. Yes.
We shall not have any opposition in this country. That one is a very pregnant statement, which is an undemocratic statement.
But Ojai,
and therefore, I want to assume that there is some external influence in most of these political parties, these opposition parties, not only in the FDC. We have seen this happening in DP. We have seen it happening in UPC. We are now seeing it happening in FDC. We don't be surprised that we are going to be also seeing it happening in NOB. So it's a planned thing, an external factor, to bring down the opposing group of people.
I like the fact that you're talking about an external factor in this particular disagreement that FDC is having. However, this has happened before in the other elections of the party in FDC. Are you saying still at that time it was an external hand that was causing those disagreements in the party?
Yeah, the external hand is not a one-off stuff. It's not an end in itself. When we say an external hand, it's a process. It is consistent. They have been deploying all means. And you have seen most members of FDC actually leaving the party. We have had Muntu leaving, Alice Alasso leaving. We have had so many prominent people. Recently, Sebo Gwao leaving. So where are they living? You know, when you ask yourself. And you definitely, you know, they can cause, you know, this is a mall, then people become suspicious, people begin fighting among themselves, and then they leave the party. So this has been a consistent move from the external factor, making sure that they break the back of FDC. And this time, I think it has been very hovered. It's now very prominent, very clear that these two factions are there, the Katonga, and then we have this now Najana Kumi, the other one is holding a delegate conference, the other one is holding a delegate conference. And if I ask myself, where are they going to end up? Where are we going to end up as a party? We may not end up anywhere. Until we come to a realization that there is an external factor fighting us. We are fighting that external factor to take over government.
Yes.
But it is also fighting back the party not to move. So this is what I would think we have to come to a realization on as FDC. And the sooner we do it, the better for us.
You seem to be standing on the margin where you don't decide, you're not decided on whether you're on the Katonga faction or in the Niger Nankumbi faction. It's like we're starting the conversation and you said you're just an FDC member. What if this does not get resolved? Are we going to see you moving out as well?
No, I want to say that I will remain in FDC. And I'm a member of FDC. And I'm not looking at personalities in FDC. Because when you look at all these two factions, there are very strong personalities behind.
Do you think this is happening because of personalities?
I think so. I think there are personalities, very strong personalities behind this. For example, in Niger Nankumbi, I think Honorable Nandala Mafabi, who is the Secretary General, is a very strong personality on that factor, on that section. Then when you come this side, you find retired Colonel Dr. Kizza Besigye, our founding father, very strong on the Katonga faction. So you can see these personalities. And in my view, I think even these people who are following Naja and people who are following Katonga, they will not leave talking about a personality like Nandala Mafabi. And then those who are following Katonga, they will not leave talking about retired Colonel Dr. Kizza Besigye. So you can now see there are very strong personalities behind these two factions.
You're talking about a faction of Katonga where the strongest personality there is Kizza Besigye, but this is a gentleman who retired from politics. Should he even have a say in this? Because he's supposed to be focusing on activism.
No, politics, you can't say you have retired from politics. Nobody can retire from politics until you are not there.
Do you think
I don't think he has retired from politics. Maybe he left FDC to look at other options to see how to fight the regime.
Do you think he should be playing a role of mediating what is happening or choosing a side? Because right now we see him choosing a side.
I don't even think now any of these faction members who are very active can mediate this impasse. Maybe you need somebody like Honorable King Pipi Ujara, who is saying, no, look, you guys, things are not working on well. We are going to break the back of the party. We need to come together and talk and see where we can end up. And we come together. Because you see, it's not yet too late, really. It's not yet too late to realize that the external factor is very strong, and then we need to come together and talk and dialogue. Because what brought us together, first of all, anyway, you know, if we start by that, what brought us together in FDC? That should be the first question. If we really know what brought us to FDC, it means therefore that then we can start talking from there.
But so these two parties have tried to talk, and
I don't think there has been any serious initiative to talk about this. We have not had any platforms. All these other platforms that we have had is either, you know, the other side or the other side. Like, for example, the recently called National Council, which was supposed to receive the Elders Committee report.
Yes.
You can see there was a lot of tension on both sides, the Katonga and then Naja. Lot of tension. And then we have had also NEC being called, lot of tension. We have had, you know, even in the Elders Council itself, the Elders report, when you look at the Elders report, is not a report. It doesn't present anything. In fact, the Elders' report should have been a very strong report that would make the two sides reconcile.
Yes.
But the Elders' report was completely biased. It was doctored. It was.
You also believe it was biased?
It was biased. Completely. I read the report. It was completely biased when it was being presented.
Seeing what is happening, and of course the Elders' report being rejected by one side of the party, do you think this party is redeemable? Are you seeing them reconciling at some point?
Yeah. As I said, until unless we know why we are in that political party. So which means we need to a kind of soul-searching, you know, initiative. We need to get to the bottom of it. Why are we in FDC? Why are we actually in politics? Why are we in the political party? What are the value system of the political party as FDC? What do we stand for? Do we have a common cause? I think we need that kind of self-reflection. And if we have had to understand it, then without greed, without personal, you know, without personal, you know, need or motive, then I think we shall redeem this pattern.
As I'm concluding this topic and I move on to the next topic, seeing tomorrow's delegates conference, Are you seeing it happening without any scuffle at all?
Well, it can happen. Even if there is a scuffle or no scuffle, it can actually happen.
But will you respect it?
But what is the legality? What is the legality associated with that? Is that the way we want to go in order to build a party? And what do we want from this party anyway? Because the issue is, you can have meetings in Katonga, you can break staff, you can fight among yourself, you can have this delegate conference going on. Then what in you yourself as a leader, do you feel what you have done is really for the good of the people who are supporting the party, or for the good of Uganda, or is for your own self, you know, interest? So this is what we need to come to understand. In my view, I think even if the delegate conference happens, what kind of leaders do you so pull out of? For example, who is going to be the party president? Who is going to be the secretary general? Who is going to be the other
neck members? It's going to be Nandala Mafabe. He's uncontested. At least that is very clear.
Now you see, is that an election? What kind of election is that? That you become the secretary general in a big political party like without any contestation? Are there no people who could have contested for that position?
Did you contest for any position?
Well, I've not contested for any position, but I was appointed the deputy party president.
I was actually selected
the deputy party president by the party, by the NEC. And currently, I'm actually a deputy party president Northern Uganda for FDC.
Very interesting. I would like to move away from the FDC question. Of course, we'll keep bringing you updates tomorrow. We'll be live in Ajana Nkumbi tomorrow during the delegates conference that will be happening there. And I want to bring Honorable Okin to another point, and that is the APA question. Just in a few minutes, tell us what the problem is in APA.
To isolate APA in Amoro, the problem, the challenges in APA land in Amoro, from the bigger question of land in northern Uganda is not to say anything.
Right.
We therefore cannot isolate the issue of APA from the bigger question of land problems.
And what question is that of land in northern
Uganda? We have had, first of all, when you look at the constitution of Uganda, I would say almost about 90% of the land tenure system in northern Uganda, especially in Acholi sub-region, is actually customary land. So which means customary land, that's how land is governed.
Yes.
It's governed according to the custom of the people. So there is no individual. 90%, I'm talking about 90%. It's only 10% probably that people have individual land. So which means land is collectively owned in actually sub-region. The majority of land is collectively owned by the people, by the clans, by the custom of the people. So which means therefore that if, for example, you want to go and you want to acquire land for development, you want to invest in land there, you need to seek the consent of those people who are owning that land.
The clan
that is owning that land. Little to that, you cannot move.
Yes.
And this is what we are seeing. We are seeing the state is stuck on this particular matter. And therefore, that's why we are seeing problem challenges in, for example, in APA. Problem challenges, for example, in places like Lakang and other, you know, communal land. Other communal land, there are a lot of challenges. This land is there, by the way, but how do you acquire this land? How do you manage this land? How do you invest in this land? Is now the biggest question, because you need to get the consent of the people. So in APA, for example, we have had a similar kind of challenge. We have had Uganda Wildlife Authority claiming some chunk of land there.
Yes,
we have had National Forest Authority claiming some chunk of land there. We have also had contestation over boundaries. you know, the boundary, you know, that this this apar belongs to Acholi or belongs to Madi. So this contestation have been there, and we have recently we have had some death, some, you know, some killing.
There have been,
and there
some
was work to by the paramount chief, you remember, he was demonstrating there because of the killing in Apa. So the government has decided to embed itself inside this kind of conflict because it has a lot of interest, because that land is huge land. Therefore, the government has got a lot of interest in it, and that's why all these things, all the time, they cannot sort out. Recently, you remember the cabinet came up with a decision that the people who are living in Apa are supposed to be compensated, and then they leave the place. But you know, this is the people who have been settling on that land from time immemorial, for so long. It's their ancestral land. They have had their ancestors there, they have had their people there. Now, you chase them to go where? And that's the question.
We have seen a commission of inquiry being set up at some point, which did not yield results. And we are seeing a new one that has been set up to go and inquire on the problem of the Apar land. Do you think it's going to yield any results?
That is a very good question. You know, if it is about investigation on the matter of Apar, I can count, I don't know how many, even parliamentary sectoral committees, even parliamentary committees, sectoral committees, were pushed to Apar to go and do investigation with all these issues we have just been talking about. And there are recommendations to that effect.
Yes.
But why are we not taking these recommendations seriously? Recently, we the people from Acholi were not happy with the president when he went to a prayer organized by his daughter in Guru.
Yes.
He made mention that
they are going to go by the constitutional orders. Yes.
Is in Ajumani.
Yes, according to the constitution.
According to the map.
Yes, that was done by the colonialists.
That according to the map, Apar is in Ajumani. Now, why are you setting that commission now? Because this commission has been set, chaired by the retired former Chief Justice, Bart Katurebe.
Yes.
That this commission is supposed to establish, first of all, the boundary of Apar, and to look at the conflict, deeply seated conflict within Apar, and also try to identify those who have been perpetrating conflict in Apar. But now you, as the executive, the chief executive, you come and say, Apar is in Ajumani. Now, what will the commission do? And as you are the head, now when you state that, you are actually invalidating the methods of work, the methods of parandi of the committee actually created, the judicial committee created.
Ojara, there is something that quite confuses me when it comes to that land issue. Yes, the people that occupy the land are the Acholi, but according to the boundaries, they say it belongs to the Madi. But this is the same issue we are seeing in Zimbabwe, whereby we have more Baganda, sorry, Banyankole in the area, but it is in the Buganda region. But we don't see so much contestation there like we do here in Apar. Why is it that Apar is the one that is facing this challenge?
Now, that's why I'm saying, you know, first of all, the Madi and Acholi are related. If I may tell you, Acholi is the product of intermarriage between Luo and the Madi.
Okay.
That's what brought Acholi. Therefore, we have not had any problem. We have had the Madi, for example, settling in a place called Atiak. There is a big chunk of big people there, big group of Madi. In Bibia, for example, there is a big community of Madi. In Elego, at the border, which is in Amoro, there is a big group of Madi settling there. So we have not had any problem. But that's why we are saying, and by the way, if you look at the patterns, for example, the voting of 1980, during Mobutu's time, the voting, subsequent voting that took place, the people of Apar have been voting in Amoro. And if you, even the services gazetted by the government here, you find Amoro district local government being given the budget for Apar.
Yes. The administrative powers were given to Amuri.
Even recently, you look at the ruling of Anthony Akol and Ojera. Because Ojera took Anthony Akol to court because he was claiming that the people of Apar voted for Akol.
Yes.
And yet the people of Apar belongs to Adjumani. Mm-hmm. So they should have not voted for Akol, who is in Amuro.
Hmm.
But there was a judgment there saying no, they voted rightly.
Because administrative, you know.
So these are very obvious things. And for me, by the way, to be honest, I'm not in for this kind of boundary, you know, kind of contestation.
Yeah.
I am looking at the issue of land rights of the people.
Talking about land rights, and as we are concluding this, we are seeing an issue of also selling land to Balalo still in the same region. What is the actual problem, or why is are Ugandans so against this?
I want you to call me back here and we talk specifically about the issue of Balalo.
Running away from
you
that
need to call me back. Yeah, no, because you see, if you look at the trend of even first of all, if you ask ourselves, we love these Balalos, but we love people, everybody, we love human beings are human beings, they are human, they are created in the image of God. And if you're a human being, you must love one another, you must stay with one another, you must appreciate one another. But how do you do this without bringing conflict? Because I can appreciate you, but if you are bringing for me conflict, or you want to deprive me of my rights, then that is where now conflict comes. So when you look at the settlement of this, the pattern of this Balalo.
Balalo, yes.
First of all, we have been asking ourselves, where are these Balalos coming from? Where are they coming from?
Where are they coming from?
That's now the question.
Yes.
We hear they're coming from elsewhere. Now, if they're Ugandans, fine.
But aren't Ugandans allowed to settle?
You know, I'm asking if they're Ugandans, fine. But if they're not Ugandans, supposing they're not Ugandans. You know, so we need to find out where, we are doing a research to find out where these Balalos are coming from. By the way, we have had Balalos before in actually sub-region. And we have been living peacefully.
Yes.
But now when you look at now the current pattern, the current pattern is different from the previous pattern of the Balalo settlement. This is a Mulalo who wants to get about 10,000 acres of land, 10 square miles, 15 square miles, 1,000 acres, 2,000 acres, 3,000 acres. In one of the sub-counties, in fact, last week I was in one of the sub-counties.
Yes.
The sub-county indigenous people have lost now 2,000 acres of land. In another sub-county, they have lost 19,000 acres of land to the Balalos.
Yes.
Is that really a normal pattern of settlement?
Well, it's very interesting, but I'm going to stop you right there, Ojera. That is all the time I have
for so
the
much.
Big issue. I hope we can invite you and we talk more about this Balalo question in the future. We are going to take a very short break, but when we return, we're going to have Miles Ramiti sitting with Huntington Bujingo from Fun Factory as they celebrate their anniversary. What has been their journey? We'll be right back.